The Slim Pigs Podcast. Slam Pigs Union Smack, Episode 6, right back here on Hibiki TMD. Another week, no UK show to talk about, but to make up for it, we've got a little tidbit to get into, but before we get into any of that, in today's episode, in our retro recap review of the first Monday Nitro, Maniac Matt Tennant, welcome back, man. This feels like take 27, but really we've only tried once, but man, we have tried to get this episode done. Finally, it seems like the hiccups are over. What's going on, buddy? Welcome back. How was your week?
It was a surprising week, and as always, Travis, it's a pleasure to be here with you, my friend, talking about wrestling once again. And before we get into this, can I just give a big shout out to my girlfriend, the love of my life, Kaylee. I love you, and pleasure shout out.
And hi, Kaylee. Thank you for listening. It has been a week, and I'm glad as always to be back doing this once again with you to escape the stressfulness of reality. But real quick, Matt, where can everyone check you out on Twitter and all that good stuff?
You can follow me on Twitter at TennantFugitDW, and you can check me and Logan out really soon on our new wrestling podcast, The Future of Wrestling.
Indeed, indeed. And follow me on Twitter at TheHibikiTMD. Check out Slam Pigs Cruise Control and regular Slam Pigs podcast with Michael, Logan, all the pallies. It's been quite the week for Mr. Pete Dunne, adding quite the amount of belts to his collection. We're up to 3 now, correct, Matt? What went down with Pete Dunne this week?
Yeah. Pete Dunne has become a triple heavyweight champion this week. And I've had a lot of people asking me about this on Twitter, so I'm glad we're doing it. Rocky, our friend Rocky, has asked for details on this. So, Rocky, this is for you.
Shout out to Rocky.
On June the 17th, shout out to Rocky, good friend. On June the 17th...
Kind of the Frankenstein for Union Smack, in a way. Kind of the creator, put it all together.
He is. Rocky introduced us, and it's been history from there. So Rocky, thank you very much.
Indeed.
At least I owe you a lot, yeah.
We both.
So... on June the 17th this year, what was it, like 2 weeks ago, something like that, Pete Dunne defeated Psycho Mike and Josh Alexander at Destiny World Wrestling Invasion to capture the Destiny World Wrestling Championship, which makes him, Travis, a triple heavyweight champion, along with his Progress World Championship and, of course, the WWE UK Championship. So, Pete, from everyone here at Slam Pigs, if you're listening... congratulations.
Congrats to Pete Dunne, one of the more decorated UK guys I can think of ever. He's reaching up there with Ultimo Dragon and Vader status when they had like 47 belts each. But man, I tell you all the time, off air, you show me these pictures of Pete Dunne and it just hurts my teeth. Like I say all the time, look at him holding these belts in his mouth. But man, when it gets up to like 5 or 6, I don't know if his jawline can hack it, man. But congrats to the Bruiserweight, my favorite UK guy. One of my favorite guys in the whole world, period, right now. Honestly.
Yeah, I agree. I agree with that. And somebody who by summer next year should be NXT champion as well.
I'm still a little fuzzy on his entire contractual status, I would say.
Yeah, me too, because he seems to be defending the UK championship like everywhere he can get booked. He defended it in a UK Lucha Underground show like 3 weeks ago. And I'm surprised WWE allowed him like to defend it. It's one thing taking it to the show and, you know what I mean, showing it off, but to defend it on a show like that. And I'm pretty sure I read he's got a UK Championship title defense coming up in America, but not on a WWE show. So what they're doing with that title right now and Pete Dunne as a wrestler, I'm not sure. I'm fuzzy on it.
I think either he's going to work out well because he's going to make a good amount of money, and I'm sure he is in the indies. And I mean, I know he'd take a bigger cut going to the NXT or whatever, but in the long run, he's so talented, he will get to the main roster, I'll call it, if he's ever NXT, and he'll make a lot more money in the long run. But we'll see. Either way, we're going to get great matches regardless of Pete Dunne, whatever promotion he's in. Another thing, since we're recording this, this is kind of newer, Matt, and I'm not familiar with this guy at all. A little bit in the news, Eddie Dennis apparently has signed with NXT. I know nothing about this guy. Some of you guys put it out on Twitter. Shout out to Kayfabe Today Podcast. They actually tweeted out. And I comment on, like, who? Just being snarky. And the actual Eddie Dennis liked one of my that tweet, and I felt like a dick. But, yeah, Eddie Dennis, man, what do you know about him from what you've seen?
Well, I don't know a lot about him. I know he's a very athletic wrestler. I know, like, the news says he signed with NXT, so his style will fit in, I think, perfectly there. I think much more than a Mike Bennett would. You know, he's gone straight to the main roster and isn't going to do anything. But I have high hopes for Eddie Dennis in NXT. He's proficient in the ring. And, I mean, I would have to go back and watch, like, some more of him. But, yeah, I'd say really good signing for WWE. And I am surprised, actually, Travis, that with him being English, they haven't signed him for the UK show first instead and just put him straight into NXT.
It's unbelievable some of the guys we saw in that tournament, like the big muscle cat, guys like that, but we didn't see this guy. And he looks like he's got something just from the photos I've seen. And some of you guys on Twitter told me to check out. So next week on Union Smack, I'm going to check out Chris Hero versus Eddie Dennis. And I'm going to talk about it a little bit if it's available on YouTube. Matt, also... real quick, 2 cents on it. The G1 USA Night 1 and Night 2 was last week. I did catch Night 1. Great job from Josh Barnett, I got to say. Surprised me how well he kept up with Jim Ross on commentary, which was it's always amazing to hear Jim Ross call New Japan matches. So congrats, Matt, to Kenny Omega, the first ever New Japan United States champion. But all that good wrestling aside, and good wrestling, there's something else that went down this week. I know you're just foaming at the mouth to talk about, Matt. So I'm stumbling over my words out of excitement. Go ahead.
You were excited there, Travis. Just made him misplaced. Yes, and if anyone doesn't know, Travis is alluding to TNA/Impact Wrestling Slammiversary 15, which was, I think it's fair to say, a shit fest. For the most part, there was a decent 4-way tag team opening. The main event was a botch fest. Wasn't terrible, but a botch fest. But there was something in this show which, if you haven't seen it, and anyone listening to this hasn't seen it, I urge you to go back and watch it, because we've sat here week after week and slated bad angles, bad wrestling, stuff like This Is Your Life with Bayley and Alexa Bliss, like Jack Gallagher on 205 Live last week. This, I have to say, has to be one of the worst pieces of
shit
wrestling. Shit, yeah. I was going to call it acting, but it can't be described as that. It was terrible, and I'm, of course, talking about the Joseph Parks and Jeremy Borash versus Scott Steiner. Scott Steiner, in 2017, he just looked like he belonged in a retirement home.
Jeremy Borash, anybody in this match in 2017?
In 2017, yeah. Against Scott Steiner and Josh Matthews. And as if the first 5 minutes of the match weren't bad enough, Joseph Parks and Jeremy Borash, who were meant to be the baby faces, they scoot backstage, run away. And then, for some reason, Impact Wrestling Director thought it would be a really good idea to pre-record the backstage fight earlier in the day. Honestly, I don't know how to describe it apart from utterly abysmal.
Well, hell yeah, Dutch Mantel was probably sitting back there in the creative going, well, goddamn, you know what this needs? Some music behind it. And there was music. They put music to this shit.
They did. They put, like, and it was meant to be dramatic, bless them. And it was meant to be, I don't know.
The
honestly,
only
Travis,
time, in my opinion, that having music play throughout an entire wrestling segment is when New Jack was in a wrestling ring. That was the only time it got a pass for me. It never works. It always comes off as hokey.
And it ruined the segment. I mean, as if it wasn't bad enough, like with the really terrible acting, and Steiner and Josh Matthews commandeering a car from somebody who had obviously been failed at acting school. Like, no one's been that pleased to see Scott Steiner since 93. And then they chase Jeremy Borash into a swimming pool. And it's Borash and it's Matthews in the swimming pool. And he does possibly the worst backdrop in wrestling history on Josh Matthews into the swimming pool. And then suddenly Jeremy Borash, who had to waddle to the ring during this match, he's suddenly fucking Neville. Like, he does a senton splash into the swimming pool onto Josh Matthews. And then we get the Jaws music, the da-da, da-da. And who comes along? Shark Boy, everyone. Oh, a really out-of-shape Shark Boy who should not be near a wrestling ring, a wrestling segment in 2017. And he, to my recollection, bit Josh Matthews and tried to pull him under. That's how bad it was. And then, thankfully, they left that alone. And we cut to Scott Steiner throw Joseph Parks through. It was the cardboard wall, and it broke like a cardboard wall did. And then we got the best part about this, which was James
there
Mitchell
was more?
Returning.
There was fucking more to cut. Like, listen to what we've gone through already, guys. And there's more. TNA.
There's more. There is more. Like, I'm missing bits out of this backstage segment to save people falling asleep.
Oh, God.
Like,
thank you, man.
There was fire extinguishers being blown in Scott Steiner's face. Anyway, so James Mitchell comes along, tells Joseph Parks to get up, and then it cuts back to the arena. Borash being beaten down by Steiner and Josh Matthews get back in the ring. Shark Boy comes back to try and make the save. It doesn't work, predictably. And then Abyss's music plays, and James Mitchell comes out on the stage, and Abyss appears in the ring behind them, and the rest, Travis, as they say, is history. Shit history, but history nonetheless.
My God, that does not
sound. And I'm bored of talking about it.
Yeah,
it
as
was,
you would.
Honestly, the worst thing I've seen in wrestling in maybe 5 years.
Christ, I mean, I just literally got done watching Brian Kendrick as a pilgrim or something yesterday. That was up there for worse.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Thank God I did not have to watch that, and you reviewed it for me. That's why you're my pally, but I would not recommend that just from listening to it. Guys, do not go out of your way to watch that. But like, you know what I'm glad I did go out of my way to do, Matt, was to take us to a place on Union Smack, 6 episodes in, we've never ventured. WCW, Matt, let's do it for the first time.
Yes, WCW.
My God, and at least, you know, there's some Dungeon of Doom going on around the time period we're going to talk about. One of the the worst stable ever, Matt, by the way, real quick.
I would say, not maybe, I would say the worst. I'm hard pushed to think of a stable that are so laughable and so, I would say so worthless in wrestling around the time of their being. Like, at least, I don't know, at least they, the Varsity Club, at least they could wrestle.
Yeah.
At least, I mean, they weren't really that relevant, but they had something that...
They weren't grown men, fat guys in singlets calling themselves sharks and, like, putting fins up in their head. I don't know. Like, the Dungeon of Doom makes the social outcast look like the Four Horsemen. Like, it was that bad.
Three-man band, like, biggest fucking stable in the world.
They make the three-man band look like Hall, Nash, and Hogan. That's how bad the Dungeon of Doom was. But, yeah, it was around that time period, late 95, September 95. Obviously, the very beginnings of the Monday Night Wars, when WCW finally decided to compete head-to-head on Monday Nights Live, not always live, because Raw was still taped every other week or once a month, something like that. But, you know, let's talk about the elephant in the room, the guy behind it, everything. Every time WCW went outside of the box in this mid to late 90s time period, the guy that should take all the credit is Eric Bischoff. He took it from the seedy-looking arenas, like when Bill Watts had the helm in WCW, and put it in MGM Studios, put the rings on spinning record players, and fucking all this zany shit. He brought in a lot of New Japan guys.
He did.
I mean, they did that earlier, but not to the extent that, like, Bischoff cross-promoted Starrcade this year with half New Japan. Bischoff went outside the box. He always doesn't get enough credit for that, in my opinion. I think he was so cutthroat at certain times, yeah, giving away Raw results. Say what you want. Way better mind, in my opinion, than Vince Russo, but a better businessman also in Paul Heyman. It was a case of Dixie Carter syndrome. He let the talent pull too many strings, and it ate itself alive from the inside out, and that's what killed it. I think the thing that people don't talk about enough when they talk about WWF winning back then, WCW was shackled by the mature ratings and stuff on the Turner Broadcast Network. WWF was allowed to go there with the foul language, with the exposing women nudity. WCW wasn't allowed to do that kind of content until it was too little too late. And I think if they had, from day one with the NWO, been allowed to go to places WWF did, we could see a different world of wrestling today, in my opinion. I totally
agree. Yes, I agree. Yeah, I agree. And, I mean, we talked about this last time, that, I mean, Eric Bischoff, all credit in the world, but if he'd have just kept around the likes of Steve Austin just for another few years, I truly believe that Eric Bischoff had the creativeness behind him to create a Stone Cold.
Even before Austin went to ECW to, like, reinvent himself, quote-unquote, you could see so many signs of Stone Cold in the Hollywood Blondes. And what they already had, it was just a case of they were relying on nostalgia too much at the time. Guys like Duggan, who squashed him at Fall Brawl that year in, like, 10 seconds. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah. That's true. I mean, I would have loved... I mean, I'm glad we got Austin in WWF because... as shitty as it can be today, it obviously wouldn't be the same had Vince gone out of business.
Right.
You know, the wrestling world today would have been, I'd say, a lot poorer. You know, I don't think WCW would have brought out the caliber of stars WWE have over the last few years. There was even talk of Mark Calloway heading to WCW in 99 when his contract came up. I don't know if you've heard that rumor.
In 97, it was like the whole year, all you heard about was Sean possibly. And it was like 99, it was like Taker's year to talk about jumping because of his contract. Yeah, I remember that every year back there in Monday Night Wars was like a new guy for months to talk about.
Exactly. And Eric Bischoff could have made that. I mean, he had stars in 95. But I will say before we get into this that one of his biggest mistakes for me would have been letting Vader leave the company. For anyone who doesn't know what we're talking about, like, if you watch this episode, the intro video has, I think, is it Sting, Hogan, and Vader on it?
Well, let's... I think they're the three. Funny you should mention it. Let's describe the intro to Nitro. It, literally, it has nothing to do with wrestling. It's like, it looks like a scene from, like, Terminator 2 or RoboCop. And you see, like, a little trail of fire go up a gasoline line. And all of a sudden, it's like projector screens of wrestling matches. Little clips.
On buildings.
And this was their intro for fucking years. Years. Through the entire NWO. They would just replace the projection screens with different clips.
Yeah.
But yeah, Vader was on one. It was like Luger... Vader, Sting, I think, doing a Stinger Splash, and of course Hogan doing.
Like, of course Hogan.
Of course, fucking Hogan.
Of course Hogan. You're not gonna watch this, ladies and gentlemen, without a lot of Hulk Hogan in
Hope
it.
Hope you like your yellow and red. Let's go back to the thing outside the box thing. If anything, if any location for a pro wrestling event took place that was screamed outside the box, this took place, the first edition of Nitro, in the Mall of America in Minnesota, yes. Eric Bischoff's backyard. It was really weird for me to determine throughout this entire show if the crowd was like a coachy, like they were being coached, or it was legit. Like they were just shoppers in a mall that, oh, look, honey, wrestling. Throughout the whole show, there's an escalator visible, Matt, in, like, every angle the camera could possibly shoot. And these things are never empty. These things are always fucking packed with people. And they just – throughout the whole show, I can never stop thinking, wondering what these people are thinking in their minds. You know what I mean? Like,
just forgetting about the shop and then it's – see them hanging over the edge of the escalator and just having a browse as they go up to whatever fucking shopping they're going to get. It's like – it's like WCW dropped a ring in the middle of a crowd who really didn't know anything about wrestling, or for the most part.
Going there for the fucking sale on Labor Day or whatever. So, look, honey. I don't know. It was hard to determine that a lot, especially when, like, we'll get to it later. I'll save it. But at the Mall of America, let's get to what they went with. Now, Matt, when I have a show and I'm going head-to-head with the biggest company in the world and I want the elite, the best on my broadcasting booth, the best the money can buy, I'm going to Steve Mongo McMichael first and foremost. I don't know about you. Because that's how I'm going to look for it.
Yeah, he'd be in my top. He'd be in my top 10, surely. My God. Can you imagine the thought process it took from Eric Bischoff? Mean Gene was there. Mean Gene was part of this company in 1995.
And Lee Marshall just hanging out, doing 1-800 collect clips and shit, doing nothing. He was Tony the Tiger's fucking voice.
So much fucking better talent out there. You could have gone out and got a non-wrestling commentator. At least there'd have been a commentator. You go and get an ex-football player.
Yeah.
An ex-American football player who... I mean, I didn't know who was watching this as a kid. Because we didn't get American football over here.
We have seen professional football players. Some of them are good. Look at... A lot of people don't like Terry Bradshaw or Howie Long, but they know their shit. They don't come off like... Bobby the Stain! They don't say that line 16,000 fucking times. And they don't stick their thumbs up little dog's ass. Like, what was up with that? Every episode, he put it in little...
God knows.
He would cosplay his dog and put his thumb up its ass, Matt. This was what we were getting.
That dog that I originally thought was a ventriloquist dummy.
But you know why? I totally know why Bischoff did it.
That
this was
dog
hot
stayed
off.
Still for so long.
They did this because it was hot off the heels of Mongo appearing at WrestleMania 11 a couple months prior in the large tail. And I totally think maybe I could see Bischoff trying to steal somebody like Ken Norton Jr. and a lot bigger names were there besides fucking Steve McMichael, like Reggie White. Maybe they just didn't want to do it, so he went with McMichael. I don't know, but he went with him. He was also being trained. That's something we need to talk about also. This time with him being on the commentary, he was being trained behind the scenes to get into the business, which we would see a year later.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Just what a bumblefuck decision to bring in Mongo McMichael. But at least you had Bobby Heenan there. And, you know, say what you want. Tony Schiavone would come in when it would go to 2 hours later on. It's like hour one. But Jesus Christ, Eric Bischoff is one of the worst lead announced guys of all fucking time. Like, oh my God. As good as he was as a businessman at times, just he was the shits in this role.
If you had a choice, Travis, between him as a commentator and Vince McMahon as a commentator, who would you go with? Because Vince McMahon's got a lot of
all
shit.
Day. You know what Vince can do that Eric can't? Bah! Body drop.
That is true. Eric Bischoff did sound quite generic throughout the entirety of his announced career. And I don't know why, because wasn't he an announcer in WCW for like 2, maybe 3 years before this?
He was like an interview. He was like a Renee Young, more or less, as opposed to a commentator. I memory's serving me. I could be wrong, though, guys. Let us know in the comments down below. But I don't think he started as a lead commentator really until Nitro, until this episode.
You think? I thought it was like at least a year beforehand.
I could be totally wrong. I just don't remember that, though.
Maybe on Saturday night or something, like WCW.
Maybe like they're one of their C shows, like Pro or Worldwide.
Yeah,
maybe.
That's what I'm getting at. Definitely not on like one of the bigger shows, but...
Maybe I'm thinking like, okay, maybe on like a guest shot. I don't remember doing it consistently. I don't know. But let us know, guys, down below. But yeah, this was the announce team. You know, visually, the spectacle of this, it looked all right, man. I didn't hate the mall thing. It was different, yeah. And it worked. I mean, the crowd, coached or not, they did come off like they were into everything they were seeing, mm-hmm. even though some of what they were seeing was some shitty shit.
it was different. I mean, if you go back and compare Nitro to anything WCW had done prior to this, television-wise, then it looked grittier from the outset. I'm not sure it looked different enough to begin with. The in-ring presentation was, let's say you took your basic samey in-ring presentation and put it in a grittier setting. Like, I thought, we'll get to this at the end, but I thought the in-ring stuff was okay. It could have been presented a bit more different for me.
I totally agree. Well, in the first match, though, see, that's the thing. I feel like the first match, and that was a good call to make Liger and Brian Pillman the first match here, yeah. on the first ever Nitro, because it's a faster paced match. You always want to get the crowd hot, get your viewers invested a little bit with a faster paced match. Yeah. I didn't hate the match. These two definitely had a much better match at Super Brawl.
Yes, they did. Like, I think collectively, that's got to be our favourite Liger Pilmer match. I know we were talking about it on Twitter not too long ago.
Well, as you said on Take One of this, also, this match featured one of the scariest slash shittiest Frankensteiners in the history of wrestling.
Oh, it was terrible. Like, I mean, there was ring rust on Pillman. You could see it on him in the first 3 minutes or so. He'd just come back from injury, fair enough. So maybe he wasn't completely confident yet out there. But Jesus Christ, a few inches left or right, he could have broke Liger's neck. And could you imagine how that would have looked live on your premiere broadcast of what
very first match, like 5 minutes in, all these friendly shoppers on the escalator, they just see this. They see paramedics and they see scrambling people panicking.
I mean, Jesus Christ.
God. Yeah, thankfully,
everyone's
though.
Everyone's screaming. Jesus.
Thankfully, he was not hurt and they pulled off the match. Like we said, not a bad match, Matt. Would you think it's a bad match?
I thought it was okay. I'm not going to go out there and say it was brilliant. It's not even the best match they've had. Like, you've alluded to the great Super Bowl 92 match they had for the
light heavyweight.
Correct me if I'm wrong, Travis. The WCW Light Heavyweight Championship.
Yes.
That was my first ever introduction to, like, light heavyweight wrestling.
These two guys had a lot. Wasn't that also to crown the first light heavyweight champion?
I think it was. I don't know. My memory recollects Pillman coming in with that title. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe
I'd love
my
to review
memory,
that match down the line at some point, Matt, with you.
Let's do Super Brawl 92 at some point.
Yes, let's do it. But let's do this today. The match, you know, the result is what it is. This is Brian Pillman injury, Matt.
Yeah, he was, I think they said he'd been injured like 4 weeks before. So if that was right, then he rushed back pretty quick. He didn't take any time between convalescing the injury and jumping back in the ring. Like, he looked like he just literally got better and next day was back in the ring. And to be honest, that showed a little bit, because did you notice like the really quick move to move, the exchanges, that there was little selling here. It was just straight out the gate, don't sell anything, straight into the next exchange.
Yeah. A lot of that could have been nerves on Pillman for, like, you know, the exposure live and the language barrier, even though they had a great match before. Who knows? Who knows what came to play with? Did this take us to the Sting promo next to
it? It was a good little promo. I mean, it was every Sting promo ever, let's be honest. There was nothing about it. He howled. Did he mention the little stingers at some point?
He always did.
He always did, yeah. And then that was it. That was the Sting promo. But it looked like a 30 seconds, maybe it was 20 seconds less, just to fill a little gap.
Yeah, this is right before he would go brunette, which was stupid, and I hated it, and I know you hated it because you've told me you've hated it. It was dumb.
Yeah,
it was dumb, and it didn't look right until he was the.
It was it was dumb, but a really big coincidence that like. It led into his crow phase. I know they didn't plan it that way, because, like you said last time, WCW didn't have a great.
They did not have that kind of
foresight
at all.
But
you know what? And Kevin Sullivan, I believe, had a lot of the book at this time. And if anybody could have that kind of foresight, I would see Sullivan being that guy, because he was a tremendous booker at certain times. But I don't think they planned that at all. I think that just worked its way into him being a brunette and shit. You know.
Yeah.
What purpose would that serve in any... Like, who would notice that besides the diehards like us that he even dyed his hair and to build that up as an angle? Like, who would give a shit? It would work out as well as Booker T and Edge fighting over a shampoo commercial at WrestleMania.
Oh, my God. We should do a podcast on the shittiest wrestling angles ever sometime.
That'd be a marathon 8-hour podcast, because, Jesus. Where did that take us next
weeks.
On Nitro, Matt?
That took us to my least favourite interview in possibly the whole of Nitro history. Pastamania, brother!
Live from Hulk Hogan's Pastamania, making its debut on the first Nitro. The terrible idea of making Italian food, alongside Hulk Hogan as a co-signed brand, for people to even think that would be a good idea, because the last thing I ever think about Hulk Hogan is a big bowl of fucking ravioli. I think of like tanning lotion and fucking racial slurs at this point when I think Hogan. It's not spaghetti. What a fucking dumb waste of time this was by these coach kids who were just happy to be on television, Matt.
I don't know what I hated most about it, whether it was Hogan going, it's six times, by the way. I might have had too much time on my hands that day, but I counted. Six times he said the line.
By the way, this entire segment was around the 3 minute mark. It was, and we got a 30-second Sting promo who actually was involved in a fucking title match. No, a non-title match, but still he was featured in a match. And we're talking about spaghetti. Yeah. Continue, Matt. Oh.
So I don't know what, oh my God, I don't know what I hated most about this, whether it was the constant pushing of Hogan's restaurant, or whether it was them irritating little kids who, they can't all have been wrestling fans, Travis. And I know I got annoyed about this on the first take of this, but...
Get annoyed again, because it's worth it. It was shit.
It's like Hulk Hogan in 95 wasn't the Hulk Hogan of 1990 or 90, even 92. You know, he was slimmer. He wasn't taking his steroids anymore.
Nope.
Let's call them vitamins to save a lawsuit. He wasn't taking his vitamins anymore.
He inflated himself into the little orange goblin, and it was creepy, and it was like the last kind of person looking like you'd want around your kids. But kids loved him still, but not as much as they did in the heyday of Hulkamania, for sure.
No.
He was passé. Kids our age who grew up and were into that were more into Bret Hart by this time, and Shawn Michaels, for sure.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I agree with that. And, like, I mean, Randy Savage was still partly relevant. And for me, Savage was much more appealing, even in 95, than a slimmed-down Hogan who was cashing a paycheck and nothing more.
But also, in a tremendously, in a big way, Savage seemed also as old school and passé, like an old act at this time as well. Because
I would say
he never really bothered to update from the rodeo clown look until like 99. Neither one of these guys until, well, obviously Hogan a year later with Hollywood, and you see that worked out well. Savage just hung on until NWO and stuff, and then finally he changed like the weird hair and stuff. But I think coming over the same time as Hogan too probably didn't help him feel like a nostalgia act. Also, that probably led to that reason. I don't know.
Yeah,
but he could still go somewhere.
But like, if you compare the two, for me, in ring-wise, Savage was much more appealing, even though he was of the old guard, than Hogan. You know, by this time, Hogan had one set routine, and it was the routine he had in WWF, just toned down. You know, it was get beat up, a few punches back, beat up some more, Hulk up, leg drop, win. And I just think Savage was much more technically masterful than Hogan. I mean, in the ring, but by 95, Hogan was a shell of his former self. And what I'm trying to say is that these kids couldn't have been surely that into Hogan. They had to be coached.
Exactly. And for all the people, you know, the old school purists like Jim Cornette, how they say that, you know, ECW and hardcore wrestling was so detrimental to wrestling. I think Hogan's paint by numbers, Hulk up and repeat the same formula every match was just as detrimental. Because it was the first time it seemed so fake. And I hate to use that word.
Yeah.
But that formula, and it never changed, like you said. What made it worse with WCW, I don't think it was Hogan, more or less. He just had worse opponents to work with and worse storylines. And that didn't do it any favors.
Yeah.
You know?
It didn't. I mean, the only time Hogan was really notable in the ring was, I'd maybe, Japan. Warrior at WrestleMania 6. Japan. But like in WWF wise, maybe Warrior at WrestleMania 6, where he had to deviate to really carry Warrior, let's be honest. And against Savage, obviously, at Mania 5, where Savage carried him. So it's hard with Hulk Hogan because he's always going to be one of the, I don't like saying greatest wrestlers in the world, because he really wasn't. He was one of the greatest entertainers.
Yeah.
Yeah, the greatest attraction. Like John Cena. He's never going to be the greatest wrestler to pure diehard fans like us.
But you saw the reaction Cena got when he came back this week. It was huge. And people do miss these attractions when they're not around. But all this was, at the end of the day, I mean, at least looking back all these years later with this Pastamania segment, it's so bad it's good humor for us. But all this was back then was a giant fucking commercial in the first episode of a show you're trying to compete with. It was bad. It wasn't even executed well. You know what I mean? Like,
it was, this was terrible. And did they just book Nitro from the Mall of America because that's where Hogan's restaurant was?
It's gotta be. Because what other good reason is there to have your first show from a mall? Like, what?
Exactly. It would be another
the thinking outside of the box shit only gets you so far. Sometimes logic eventually does have to come into play at some point. I still applaud him for going outside of the box this, but looking back, that's the main reason. It had to be. You're right.
Yeah, it would be another hell of a coincidence if it wasn't. Like, just, oh, and by the way, we booked this show here, and look whose restaurant's upstairs. You had too much of a coincidence for me.
Now that the spaghetti sauce is flying and all that good stuff, all the little kids are fed and their bellies are full of terrible Italian food. Where did the linguine train lead us next on this show, Matt?
It led us to a non-titled match between WCW United States Champion Sting and the Nature Boy, Ric Flair.
Okay. First episode, non-title. Match.
nothing matters. Nothing up for grabs. What was the point?
Ric Flair and his fucking I look like a women's volleyball coach bowl cut at this time was just terrible.
Yeah.
God. It's hard to take Nate seriously with his hair. It always was every time he rocked it.
Yeah.
This match, it was a good Sting Nate match. It was exactly what you'd probably picture in your head if you close your eyes and pictured a rushed, not much time given to it, Sting and Flair match.
It was, and I mean, to begin with, the whole attention was taken off of it with Luger coming out at the beginning of the match. You know, the Luger stole the thunder from this match. I think if he hadn't have returned. When he did.
Who?
Because
I thought that was the host at fucking Pastamania. How many are in your party? He looked like a waiter. The legendary waiter's jacket, suit, whatever.
He did in that awful shirt he was wearing with a frill around the neck.
I thought it was a given rule, unless you're in a religion or it's like a formal event. Like, you don't button your button at the top, Lex, unless you're like on the clock as a waiter. But you know what's so funny about this? Every time I've watched this, because God knows this is on so many fucking documentaries, this clip. Just look at the security guards. Look at the reaction. It's like, because you could tell they're not fans, and they see the way Luger's dressed, and I guess his hair, even in 95, was very, and they're just like, this fucking guy. It's awesome. If anything, you got to check out the security guards. Shout out to them. But yeah,
I agree, he totally stole the heat. He did, because no one expected it. You know, this was a non-internet age, let's not forget. So, I mean, if the internet had been around, it would have been all over 2-3 hours before it went live, or Luger's coming back. But this was a time when fans didn't really know who was going where.
We hadn't seen that yet. We had not. I mean, when Randy Savage, when he left, Vince McMahon had that clip on Raw thanking Randy Savage for his time and sorry we couldn't come to terms. It was even addressed. We didn't see anyone cutthroat do this kind of shit until the Lex thing. Lex did a lot of firsts for wrestling. First guaranteed type contracts as far as money, if I'm correct. It was Lex. He was one of the first guys, if anything, I should say. Kind of a trailblazer in the way that money is handled for these guys today.
Yeah, I agree. And this wouldn't have been such a shock. This wouldn't have been such a shock had he not been wrestling for Vince the night before.
Yep.
I think this was a very, very well done bit of business by Eric Bischoff, who saw Luger obviously at the end of his contract and then thought, do you know what would be the biggest little finger to Vince like right now, this week? Let's steal. And I'm not going to say one of Vince's main stars, because by 95, Luger was out of the main event picture in a tag team with Davey Boy, the Allied Powers.
And Davey just turned heel a month before this happened. So WWF is kind of like, what do you do with him?
That's it. We've got nothing to do with him. He wasn't a main event star in 95. He was, I mean, you might hate me for saying this, Travis, because I know you like Luger Express to an extent, but I'd say he wasn't even really a main event guy in 93.
No, that's their fault. He could have been. They booked that SummerSlam 93. There's never been a match that fucked a guy's push so much in my life that I've ever seen besides that. Think about it.
Yeah, I mean.
That was the area where predictability was the norm. It was like a given that Lex was going to win that belt. That was like the era of Hogan being so pretty. You know what I mean? So, and that's the thing. Yeah. They tried to make him the next Hogan. It never worked because he was no Hogan as far as charisma.
No. No, he had very little charisma and very little in the ring wise. You know, like Hogan, he relied on a set arsenal. I just think if they'd have given this match 7-8 minutes longer, cut that fucking Pastamania gimmick out.
Yes.
Cut out the, I know, your least favourite part after this, the Michael Wall Street promo. And cut the main event in half as well.
They had a card with Sting and Flair on it and Liger and Pillman on the same card. And they went there with Pasta. Squandered it.
They did. Right. And what was Eric Bischoff thinking? Like,
he was thinking money. I mean, business-wise, he was thinking that God knows he was thinking the almighty dollar with Pasta Mania, like co-branding and all that shit. Like we said with the location and everything, but I don't know.
Yeah, was this? I mean, we never heard of Pastamania after this, but
thank God. Yeah, I don't think you ever heard about it again on a prominently. I mean, maybe a couple weeks on Nitro after this, but yeah, like it just faded away.
So I'd have took all that time and I'd have plowed it into your mid-card attraction match for the title. Somehow changed the ending. I know they wanted Anderson and Flair build for the pay-per-view, but. Flair could have sustained a pinfall loss, no problem.
Yeah.
You know, he was Ric Flair. You can pin him in the ring and he'll lose no image.
Exactly. He was established. Sting and Flair were established enough to they could eat a pin, you know?
Yeah.
But I mean, anyway, they booked it.
Sustain a loss from anyone. That's how they booked it. And it was good, not great.
Speaking of things that are neither of those words, bad. This promo next with the former IRS, I believe that's where we're at now, the VK Wall Street promo, Matt.
Yeah, we are.
This was just a standard case of WCW, stealing WWE talent, and they can't use the trademark, and this is the best they can fucking come up with as a cop-off. God, it was bad. The promo was bad. The gimmick didn't make sense. He was a tax man, now he's on Wall Street. I mean, Wall Street people were cutthroat, but I don't know if I want him as a wrestling character. Maybe it's just me. It was never good. When he went to the NWO, Mike Rotunda in this time, it was. Should he have just retired? I don't know. It was because he didn't do it.
I think he should have just retired. I mean, credit to him for trying to make this shit work. Yeah. Because, I mean, he did try. Like, it wasn't his fault he got saddled with basically a samey gimmick, just tweaked to. You know what I mean? A different characteristic. And I always quite liked Mike Rotunda in the ring. I mean, I know in his IRS days he wasn't on top of it all the time, but when he was Mike Rotunda in the Varsity Club, he was good.
I agree. I think he's always, even in the US Express, he was a really good tag team wrestler.
Yeah, with Barry Windham.
I just think it's always a case of when you take a gimmick, and it comes off like it's the light version of it, and because you can't, like with Avalanche as Earthquake in WCW, and they did the shit with TNA when those guys would come, it never works because nobody wants, you know, people would rather have Pepsi than a generic Pepsi from the grocery store, I guess. But I mean, we never had to fucking watch this again, Matt, so that's good. Was it main event time?
Thankfully, and this just another cash in the check. Yes, it was. Boy, oh boy. This just bored me to tears.
At quick glance, I thought it was Hulk Hogan fighting Roadkill from ECW because of the attire on Big Bubba Rogers. This was the main event on their first fucking show. Not for the world title. None of that. Nope.
No.
You're not getting it for free. You gotta eat your pasta, kids. You gotta order the fucking spaghetti first before we give you the title match. This was shit. This match sucked. The Boss Man Hogan match in a steel cage was 10 times better than this, Matt. What did you think?
I agree. I totally agree. And can I just say, I timed this match on the network, and from entrances to the final bell, it was 15 minutes. It was 15 minutes, Travis, of
boredom. Pure boredom.
Yeah, boredom.
Punch, rest hold, leg drop.
Kick, punch, bollocks, crap.
Wait,
you know,
I forgot a boss man slam with a Hulk up. That's, you know, you knew that was coming in this match.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. It, really
it does
doesn't,
not
I mean,
fucking matter what happened in this match. It is as bad as it sounds. It was terrible. And another schmoz finish, or like Luger came out to save the day, and Hogan was like, "What are you doing here,
yeah.
Luger? What are you doing on my turn?"
I mean, Hulk won by pinfall.
Yes,
Hulk won by pinfall.
I think but, I literally have never made it through this match all the way without dozing off a little bit. I swear to God, it's one of those.
I was tempted
for you,
to fast forward it slightly. I was tempted to fast forward it, but the wrestling fan in me thought you might actually miss something good. And then at the end of that match, I looked back at that wrestling fan in me and said, "You're a dickhead. Of course you weren't going to miss anything good."
You got Mean Gene being uncomfortable wedged between all these big sweaty men. He's always Mean
yeah,
Gene didn't
true.
Get two shits, man.
Did any of us? I mean, this was a it's a basic 95 boss man. In 93, he wasn't setting the world on fire, so.
At least it wasn't the Guardian Angel gimmick. Jesus.
That is true.
But he would later go heel as big, or he would be with, he would change his gimmick a little bit. He was already a heel, excuse me. Then, like, he would shave John Tenta's head until he went to the NWO. And that was the stint of the boss man in WCW.
Yeah.
But this was, you know, you had Hulk Hogan's pallies, you had fucking big, the Dungeon of Doom came out, I'm pretty sure, Matt, like Kevin Sullivan or somebody.
Yeah, they did, yeah. Yeah, the Zodiac, Kevin Sullivan, Kamala in
Kamala,
95,
yes.
On the WCW show.
We almost made it out of this episode with no Dungeon of Doom appearances. They waited until the very end to give him.
They did. And the Zodiac. Can I just say how fucking stupid did Brutus Beefcake look dressed as a man zebra? Let's be honest. That's what he was.
He looked like one of those little delicious zebra Little Debbie cakes. The zebra cakes. Those things are awesome. Shout out to my friend, the Prodigal Jay. Those are his favorites. I don't know why I know that, but I do. Legit.
Look, nice little bit of knowledge there. Yeah. But this was, I mean, and of course, like, the Dungeon of Doom come out. Lou Group comes back to help Hogan. Challenges him for the title. Now, can I just point out two things on this? Number one, the great big fuck-up in the speech that Hogan gave, where he says to Luger, "You don't have to wait a month. You don't have to wait a week. You get your title shot next week on Nitro."
Yeah.
What? Had you know what I mean? Had the writers given up on this, like everybody else?
Right here at the Silver Dome.
And number two, this wasn't meant to be Luger for all the history knowledge buffs. This was meant to be Vader, but he'd left the company after a backstage incident with Paul Orndorff.
Yep.
And Luger was, I'm not going to say the best replacement they could get. Luger was a replacement.
Yep. And that was how they went off the air, with a little awkward stare down with, "I'll see you next week in a week," or whatever the fuck Hulk said. And that was Nitro Episode 1, Matt. We did it. At the end of the day, was it a success, a way you would want to kick off your new show, or was it an utter fail? Or in between?
I'm not sure. I mean, opening match could have been better. It was good, could have been better. Middle match was basically the attraction match. Good, could have been better. Main event, just, I wouldn't have booked it at all unless it was a... I'd have booked this as a six-man tag, Travis, to be honest.
Yeah.
Hogan, Savage, Sting.
You need all your big names in there for this show. You got to expose who these guys are for new eyes at the end of the day.
Exactly. You know, and a Flair could have taken... Oh, I didn't want a team with... But I didn't want Bubba Rogers to be any fucking where near the main event. But if he had to be, put him in a six-man with Flair and any other fucking heel you can think of.
Yeah.
You know, just to hide the flaws.
And I think for me, at the end of the day, that's why I think this was a fail. They didn't do a good enough job. They waited until the tail end to bring out most of the guys, I would say, that they want. But there were so many guys they left off of the show. It's criminal, you know?
It was. I mean, Arn Anderson was there at ringside. Put him in a match.
And I know you got, you know, they only had an hour, guys. Well, damn, it's amazing what NXT can do with every hour they're given every week. And they do a good enough job getting the guys they want exposed out there. So it is possible. They just didn't do it good here, so honestly, we all know that what history would unfold. It would get much better for a good year, year and a half maybe with Nitro. That was solid until it just shit the bed. And that was the end of the day, Matt. We did it. We have traveled down south to Turnerland, well, Minnesota for this Nitro. But anyway, Matt, episode 6 is in the books. We have done it. Until next week, where are we heading next time, my friend?
We are heading to Rebellion 2001, I believe we agreed. Back to the United Kingdom, back to good old England, good old Blighty. And I've got high hopes, Travis. I looked at the match card for this last night. I've got high hopes.
I have this on VHS. And I know this has a cage match. This has a cage match to kick off the card, if I'm correct, right?
Edge versus Christian.
Yes. I'm looking at it right now on my shelf, and I can't wait to talk. It's a good little show. It's much. There's no Tiger Ali Singh in sight in this time in the Attitude Era. So that's
Thank
good.
Cross for that.
One more time, Matt. Where can everyone check out on Twitter and all that good stuff?
You can check me out on Twitter at TalentFutureDW and catch me and Logan on the Future of Wrestling podcast coming your way really soon.
Chip, chip, cheerio. You can always catch me at the Hibiki TMD on Twitter. Check out the Reset Button podcast, myself and Tatum. Slam Pigs, myself and Michael. Cruise Control, myself and Logan. And as always, this show, Union Snack, with my friend Maniac Matt Tennant. We'll see you next week for Rebellion. Until then, cheerio, mates.
Cheerio, mates.
Hey, you dirty fucking pigs. Mike here from the Slam Pigs podcast, reminding you once again to check us out on Twitter, whether it be the Slam Pigs podcast, whether it be me at Mike the Slam Pig, or whether it be our sister show, The Reset Button. Check us out. Also, you can find us on Facebook at the Slam Pigs podcast or The Reset Button. And as always, make sure you check us out as a whole on Hibiki TMD. Until we see you next time, oink oink.